morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Just checking out. Man, how rude. Good to see y'all this morning. I'm glad you're here. Y'all make sure you greet Gloria afterwards. She turned 45 today. And so I always like it when a woman finally makes it out of the 30s. You know what I'm saying? You know, because y'all are 30 forever. And let me give you another a praise before I start, which is kind of weird. I just have to zone out, push out, do something. But Mark's back there recording. Someone decided we needed to be and videotape what we do, and which should be interesting in and of itself. We might make a whole lot of money off these, like in funniest home videos or something. But it's awesome. It's a neat piece of equipment. One of these days soon, we'll probably live stream. And so if you're really tired, you just pop up in bed. You know what I'm saying? Wouldn't that be? But you got to swipe your credit card before it comes on. I'm working on that one. There was something else I was going to share, but we're going to get to God's word. Let's pray together. Father, Lord, we love you. Thank you for blessing us and watching over us and, Father, directing our lives. And so, Father, we pray that you'll meet with us this morning. I pray that you give us clarity of thought and understanding of your word, as well as how you desire to work and move in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We're looking at life after the resurrection, and I'm following Peter's life, but in the adventure of following Peter's life, we need to look in the book of Acts. And so for a while, in several weeks, we're just pretty much going through the book of Acts. Because then we looked at Acts chapter 1 and the apostles together, and of course Peter is with them. There's 120 people in this upper room, and they're doing the business that needs to be done. They're waiting on the Lord, they're reading scripture, they're fellowshipping together, and they're in unity of one accord. And so we're going to get to chapter 2 this morning, but we're only going to make it through the first two verses, or three, maybe four, if we're lucky, I think four. And then we're going to go to the other part, because the most interesting thing about talking about the Holy Spirit of God is people just, either way, I mean, you know, there's people who get all fired up, that's all they want to talk about. There's people who get, oh man, this is weird, let's not talk about it. And so my goal, I've pastored long enough that I'm just going to approach this verse by verse and just lay it out. I'm not going to run a whole lot of trying to connect this to this unless it's in context of what's going on. Because you get messed up with the Holy Spirit. Someone can move verses and really mess up your thinking about the Holy Spirit of God. Now, I will say this from the onset, that we do need a lot more moving of God's Spirit. I just want you to know, I've been in Baptist circles today where there's a whole lot more moving of God's Spirit than we experience at times. It's not a bad thing. The problem is people move to emotionalism instead of scripture. And I'll try to break that down, but we're just going to lay some groundwork this morning, and I hope it frees us up to understand how the Spirit of God really desires to work and move in our life. God gave them to us as a gift. Right? Amen? You still with me, Dave? You need that pillow? I'm going to make that video. I just think that was cool. You know, that wasn't in my notes. Most things I say aren't. Anyway, Acts chapter 2. Look here with me. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Now, we just get to the very first phrase, and I want you to see the day of Pentecost. And the whole word Pentecost today in our minds conjures up things that aren't the definition of Pentecost. Some of y'all will be just surprised to understand that the word Pentecost, are you ready? This is what it means. The 50th. Well, I just took the air out of the whole Pentecostal church. We're the 50th church. I don't know about you. I want to be number one. Who will be the 50th? What church you go to? 50th. Next time you see someone going to the Pentecostal church, say, why don't you go to that 50th church? Just, what are you talking about? We're the Pentecostal church. And it becomes a badge of honor. You know, we're Pentecostal. But understand, it just means the 50th. It was the 50th day after Passover, and that word should be one, not Passover, but Passover. Understand? I read this 50 times, and when I'm live is when I catch more errors. And it was the feast of the harvest and giving of the law, okay? The Jewish system had feasts that really are pictures to a lot of things that have gone on. Some are fulfilled. And I want us to just spend a minute to kind of understand that the day of Pentecost was in God's plan from the beginning. The apostles didn't cause the day of Pentecost. It wasn't that they were together. It wasn't that they were praying. It wasn't that they were in unity. And God said, "Woo, look at that party. Let's do Pentecost." No. Pentecost was planned. Listen, just follow along with me. We could spend a month in Leviticus chapter 23. If you want, just take some time. Those are where God lists the feast, and it's just there for us if you want to be Jewish. But anyway, Passover, I know that's a little blurry, but I didn't want to retype it, so I stole it, okay? And I gave credit. You know, it's funny, I listened to two sermons last week at different places, and after the first one, I was like, man, that's a book I read. And they never gave credit to the book, but they did post the picture of the front of the book on there, and I was like, anyway, I didn't say anything, you know. And then later that night, after the second, Moose and I are talking. He goes, "He just preached Dr. Raynard's book on I'm a Church Member," and he didn't give him credit. And I was like, "Yeah." And the guy in chapel, "Did you read the book?" "Uh-huh," because that's what he preached. And we saw it in the bookstore later. And he goes, "Every point," and he never said anything. I was like, so when I steal, matter of fact, y'all know because it's better. But I tell you, I stole it. And so this is from Jimmy DeYoung's website, Prophecy Today, which is up at the top. Here's the thing. Passover was a Jewish feast, and it was fulfilled in Christ, right? It was fulfilled in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. He was the Passover lamb. Matter of fact, Galatians 4:4 says, when the fullness of time was come, it was a planned out event, just like Pentecost. The fullness of time. Understand this, God has a plan. Y'all understand that? He's not in heaven going, what are those people doing? He has a plan. And I always like the illustration. It helps me a lot. I've never been on a cruise ship because I just want to be able to get away when I need to get away. I just think a cruise ship, halfway through, I'd be going, I couldn't pack, and there's crazy people on here. You know what I'm saying? And so I just had that phobia of a cruise ship. Matter of fact, a plane ride 9 hours is scary to me. It's like, look, man, we're stuck with each other. Anyway, where was I before you interrupted me? Fullness of time. He came, he had an itinerary. But the cruise ship, here's the thing, God has a plan. No matter what I do on that cruise ship, unless I have a bomb, it's going to keep doing what it's doing. And I have freedom to walk. I can go to deck one, deck two, how many other decks there are, pool on the front, pool on the back. I have freedom in God. But my freedom is never going to deter God's itinerary. See, understand that. We got to get back. I struggle with people going, you know, someone sinned, and they're getting judged for their sin. And as Christian, we go, hey, God has a plan. Yeah, for you to repent. Now, he can take sin and do something good in your life if you repent of what is going on. I'm way ahead of my thoughts, but I want you to get this out. Understand, in God's plan, we live in a fallen world. And I'm really tired of the whole philosophy. Why am I sick? We live in a fallen world. Praise God, you weren't sick sooner. We're in a fallen world. Well, we're redeemed. We should be better. We still die. God kind of gave me that thought a few weeks ago. It's like, faith healers, if you really want to do something, stop people from dying. That'd take care of the other. Stop me from getting old. Preserve me like he did Gloria. She's only 45. Anyway, fullness of time. Here, secondly, then there was the unleavened bread, right? And it was really the burial of Christ, they say. It was a picture of that. Well, unleavened bread, the feast on unleavened bread, is basically they took all the leaven out, right? And it's a picture of sin. Now, I want you to understand this. See, our sin is taken away with Christ. Our sin is taken away in Christ. And then the third feast is talked about is the first fruits, and it's a resurrection of Christ. And you can read it, it all plays out. And then the last feast fulfilled right there in all that is going on is the feast of weeks, or Pentecost. And it's where they celebrated the law. They do now, but back then it was just the first fruits and the harvest. Not the first fruits, but the harvest of what's going on. Now, just so you know, these were the spring feast and really fulfilled in Christ. I'm not a feast expert. You might have a little different twist on it. I like more of the New Testament, just so you know. But then the next feast is in the fall. It's the Feast of Trumpets. Now understand, it is not the rapture, it's the second coming of Christ. There is no sign for the rapture other than we're gone. And so let me just give a little more theology. Matthew 24:30 says this, "And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. Then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. They shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory." What's he coming to do? Reign and rule. Reign and rule. We're coming with him. Matthew 24:31 says, "And he shall send his angels with" what? "A great sound of a trumpet. And they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." Now, how can we plan out when the second coming is coming? Well, you just calculate 7 years after I'm gone. I mean, the theologians can put it all together after we're raptured out and go, "Ooh, wait a minute, we can figure this out. We'll know the Antichrist." People say, "Well, God said we'll know the Antichrist." And listen, he also said there would be many antichrists. Right? We don't know which one falls, but there's a whole lot. We don't want that it's going to be the antichrist. So get this whole picture. God had an itinerary. I want you to just get the understanding that God has a plan from Adam all the way to eternity future. I was in the gas station this morning talking to someone, and I guess there's this big volcano I missed that blew up somewhere and is throwing stuff everywhere. Somewhere South America, is that right? And anyway, he was saying that. And then the earthquake in Nepal, we need to pray for the people, God, and all that's happening. And it always stirs in time. All these things are going to happen. There's going to be signs of things happening, and there's signs, and there's wars and rumors of wars and all these tragedies that are taking place. And we just got to talking. I said, God never made this world to last forever. He never made the world to last forever. If you're driving a 25-year-old car, they didn't make it to last forever. You know what I'm saying? One day it's just going to get... God made this world to last until he's done with it. I want to take care of it. I don't want to do anything just to be rude to the world. But understand that all those people who want to preserve it for billions of years, you just missed it. You better park it in the garage somewhere and do nothing, because it's just going to fall apart. But understand, we're in this church age, right? Right here. Pentecost, which some believe is the beginning of the church. I actually think it kind of started a little before it was empowered at Pentecost, because I just believe there's an overgap, but many people want hard lines. All the way to the rapture, we're in this parenthesis. There's not a whole lot in Scripture about this parenthesis. It's the church. God stopped working with the Jews other than keeping them where they are and gathering them where they are and going to use them in the future. But he has a different, peculiar people today. Just look to the person next to you and say, you're the peculiar people today. And you can say it and believe it. And listen, I'm not going against Jerusalem because, or Israel, because God wants them there. That's like going against God. Just trust me. But they're not God's chosen people today in the sense that we want to make it. You and I are. We're the church, right? And then what it says in the New Testament, he says the same thing about the church in the New Testament as he said about the Jews in the Old Testament. It's a good thing. And so as we start, we're just on the word Pentecost. 50. It was a planned event in God's timetable. A planned event. Praise God that he has a plan. And I love this little thing. Praise God's plan is bigger than your mistakes. I just like that. This morning, we need to celebrate that we got a God who is on his throne and he's doing what he's supposed to do. He's working. Well, why are bad things happening? We live in a fallen world. Why is there sickness? We live in a fallen world. You know, people come up with strategies. If you do A, B, and C, you'll be healed. I always think it's fascinating that the blind guy in the Bible wasn't getting healed until Jesus showed up. You could have had 450 million blind guys or faith healers going to be healed. No, God said he's my object lesson. I don't know about you. Sure changes your mind when you start to pray for the will of God, isn't it? Not my will, but yours be done. This guy's blind from birth. Why? So God can use him as an object lesson later? For his honor and for his glory? Not my will, but yours be done. Remember Jesus in the garden? Not my will, but yours be done. And see, if we become people again that will understand Pentecost didn't come because someone desired Pentecost to come, but Pentecost came because God had a plan and a purpose to send his Spirit, and Jesus told him all the way through the Gospels, hey, when I leave, I'm sending someone back. Right? All right, let's move on just a little bit. God has an itinerary. Get that planted in your mind. Planned from before the foundation of the world until the world is consumed by fire. Beginning and Alpha and Omega. 1 Peter 1:20. Who verily was foreordained, like this, before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times. What a God. You say, didn't someone mess it up? You can't mess up the plan of God. Because who's the giver and taker of life? You think God would let someone get in the way of his itinerary? God. We cannot cause, now listen to this. We cannot cause God's plan or stop his itinerary. We can only by God's grace join him. Now I want you to get that thought. If God has a plan, I want to be on the tour bus. You know what I'm saying? I want to be where God is moving. You say, but I want God to join my tour. God's like, no, you're going to join in what he wants to do. And see, we got to get back to where God is more important than you and I. He died for us and loved us to bring us into His family for His honor and glory. But God, right, is more important than you and I. More important than us. We're His creation. And we've made a culture, a very pathetic culture, where we're in. Well, why is God going to do that to me? Why not? He's God. But I need to be blessed. Get where God is. And your mindset of what a blessing is changes. You know, and this week I'm telling you, God's given, I hate at the same time that I'm motivated by God's blessings. Because I want to be motivated by God. But I got a little excited this week when I bought Ghana tickets for 35 people for less than $1,400 a piece. I didn't pay for them yet, just so you know. We're just going to send deposits. But, because last year they were about 1,800, so you understand, just do the math on 30 times 400, and you start seeing, woo-hoo. And then the same afternoon, it's like Christmas. About an hour after I got that, I'm already feeling like Christmas. Y'all like Christmas? I like Christmas. And someone brings in the camera, and they said that we bought the camera and got some accessories. Accessory box was huge. Like Christmas. You had Christmas, like toys. And the guy there goes, "You want to read the instructions?" "No, we're putting this together." You know what I'm saying? It's, reading instructions will ruin the excitement of the toy. Amen? Y'all been there? After a little while, we go, "Wonder what this button do?" And we read the instructions. Technically, I text Mark and say, "Hey, there's some instructions up here. Need to be read." Because I don't get excited over that part. Some other blessings. And it was like, wow. You know, this last week, too, I won 4 tickets to the Cardinals game. Citizens Bank. For $450, you can go with me. July 30th. Anyway. How many like the blessings? You like blessings. But I get bogged down because I hate that I'm more excited about the blessing than to be about God's glory. But God knows who I am and knows I like blessings. And so the blessings are okay. But look, Ephesians 2:10. Where did time go? "For we are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus before unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them." Okay? So understand God has an itinerary. Praise God, He does. He has a plan that I can't mess up. Amen? Are you in on that? That is just awesome. If you could just stop for a minute and go, out of this chaos, God has a plan. God is doing something. I turn the news on today and I'm like, whoa. But God still has a plan. Acts 2:2. Suddenly. Did you get the word suddenly? Yeah. We always go, well, they were one accord in one place. And all right, now the Spirit came. The Spirit of God would have came on the day of Pentecost if only Peter was sitting in that room going, "What's up?" Why? It was on the itinerary of God. Do you get that? You understand the falling out of the Spirit of God in Acts 2 was going to happen on the day of Pentecost, regardless of what's going on. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. As a rushing mighty wind. You don't know what it is. I like what John Piper said. I think it sounds like a train. A tornado. I don't know. They didn't know. They just say, hey, there was this noise that kind of awakened all of us. And suddenly, and it filled the house where they were sitting. So the Spirit of God comes onto this house, this place that the 120 disciples are with, I believe, women also. And the Spirit of God comes and it fills the place, and it's a sudden event. It's not a worked up event here. It's a sudden thing. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as fire. Now, listen, it as fire. It wasn't fire. You know what I'm saying? And some people, well, that's fire. No, as fire. What does that mean? I have no clue. But I'm telling you, if my tongue caught on fire, the meeting would be over. We'd be heading to the water trough. Amen? It wouldn't be 120 people going, dude, man, there's fire. You know what I mean? You get it, it's as by fire. It's not real fire. I just want you to know, because some people, you know, miss some of the little words. And it fell on who? Each of them. Who all had it? Just one or two. Just the ones who are really, really into me. No, everybody. Okay? I want you to understand. I think we connect the dots. And in this portion of Scripture, there's a conjunction, and they were filled. We're going to look at the conjunction, and they were filled, because I think it's important next week. But I believe the first half is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And because it was an event God said was going to happen. Now listen, things happen. There's a difference between the baptism of the Holy Spirit and being filled with the Spirit. Now I've read a few books, and I like reading people who don't agree with me. And it's just amazing. You know, some guys writing, there's three baptisms. I've never heard it in my life. But there's a baptism of the water, and there's a baptism by Jesus, which he says this is, and then there's a baptism that the Spirit does. And I'm like, well, dude, you're running out of Scripture. And here's why theologians end up doing that, because case A was proven wrong, so now they got to insert something else, just so you know, because you can't be wrong. And I'm open to be wrong, but I'm just going to walk through it and let God kind of help us see what it is. Remember in Acts 1:5, for John truly baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. So Jesus ascending says, not many days, 10 days later, he ascended on the 40th, right? In 40 days he appeared. 10 days later he says, and who's baptizing here? Jesus. What's the water here? The Holy Spirit. What's happening? Being immersed in the Spirit of God. Look, Matthew 3:11, he said, I indeed baptize John speaking with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoe I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Again, who's baptizing? Jesus. Jesus is the one taking us and baptizing us. It's not like I'm seeking it. It happened suddenly. It's I'm waiting on it. And why were they waiting on it? Because the Spirit couldn't come until Jesus left. And I'm telling you this morning, everyone who gets saved gets baptized into the Spirit of God. They get immersed into it. And it says, he shall baptize you. It will happen. It's not something I need to seek. Okay, now the filling of the Spirit is going to be a little different. We're going to get there. But please understand, the baptizing of the Spirit of God is something Jesus does when you get saved. He gives you the Spirit of God, and he places you in the body of Christ. And so praise God that I'm in. Not only that he have a plan, but I have a ticket to get on his itinerary. You know what I mean? Yeah. You know, we were in New York, and they got these buses. They're the coolest buses in the world, where you sit sideways, and they got these big windows, and you're in this climate control thing, and you're just driving around, and you just get to sit there, and you can just see out. It's like you sit not facing the front of the bus. You face the set, and it's like a stadium. There's like three rows, and they make fun of people and talk about people down the road, I'm assuming. Because then we went and said, hey, how much was it to get on the bus? And it was over $100. Man, I can go. I'll tell you how it was, kids. Y'all stay on the corner here in New York. We'll be back. And you know, no, here's the coolest thing. And I'm on God's bus. How much it costs to shed blood of Christ, but it was paid for in full. And I get to get on. And I want you to know, I'm just on the tour of God's itinerary. Not my will, Lord, but yours. We're just going along. We're seeing the sights. We're enjoying. Yeah. Do I get down? Yes. Do I have things happen that I'm like, God, why are you doing it? Yes. Do I have situations? Yes. Now, I want to give you a story. I'm going to put it up, but we're going to probably read it faster than you can read it. But it's on D.L. Moody. Every spirit-filled book I've read, they always want to go to the life experience of Dr. D.L. Moody. Now, D.L. Moody was an evangelical who, and now there's Moody Bible Institute is still there, and a great man of God. Now, it's always fascinating because those who are not wanting to talk about tongues will talk about his experience, and those who do want to talk about his experience, but his experience never mentions anything about tongues. It's not pro or against, but I want to just kind of whet you where we're going next week, your appetite a little bit, and hopefully we can understand it. But praise God, I'm in. Praise God, he has an itinerary. And look what happens in Dr. D.L. Moody's life. Moody continued to hunger for a deepening of his own spiritual life and experience. Now listen, God, I hope we long for more of God. We need that. But listen, his own spiritual life and experience, he had been greatly used of God, but felt there was much greater things in store for him. Stop for a minute. We don't want an experience for an experience. We want an experience. We want God to move for his work. Church isn't Six Flags. We don't come and go, woo, let's get in the hymn line. I feel like a hymn today. Praise God. It's, oh, let's get over here on the praise line. I like praise line. The Holy Spirit's not a roller coaster. We just get on and say, oh, we're going to experience that. Everyone sit down. Woo, we get to the top. Spirit really gets you. You put your hands up. You got to put your hands up or you won't experience the God. And so, woo! And we come down and we leave church going, woo! And I love that ride. And we talk about that ride. And Monday, our life is like, boy, that ride was fun. No. Spirit of God isn't something just to tickle your little belly. It's to equip you to do the work. So understand that in the experience of D.L. Moody. Now, let me just throw this little dip here because you need it. I know we're reading about experience of D.L. Moody, but I don't really care what happened in D.L. Moody's life other than it happened. My theology is here. I can't debate what you experienced. You experienced it, but it doesn't make it right. Right? Everyone ever go see a magician somewhere? And you could even be sitting on the front row. It's not like the one we had in Upwards. He was geared to little kids. But, I mean, I've been to some, and it's like, and when you go away, he cut that woman in half. I saw it with my own eyes. And you're like, there's no way you can cut a woman in half and they still walk around and live. Huh? Oh, he did. I saw it. Now they got these magicians that make planes disappear. Isn't that cool? See, they say in the audience, now I only watch it on TV with it. World, make this plane disappear. But they can do it, right? Your experience can't be your doctrine. You can be tricked by your experience. Tuck that in here, okay? Because I can't. Well, what did I experience? Because now you sent me on a limb that's just going to break and fall. Because if I try to introduce theology to an experience, people get mad. But we got to state this theology. Okay, here, in the year 1871, was a critical one with him. He realized more and more how little he was fitted by a personal requirement for his work. Amen. I think every pastor gets there about every Monday. What in the world am I doing? And how much he needed to be qualified for service by the Holy Spirit's power. Needed. I want us to understand we're going to look at being filled with the Spirit, and we need the filling of God's Spirit. This realization was deepened by conversation he had with two ladies who sat on the front pew in the church. Man, I thought it was a new thing, but hey, two ladies is too much. He could see by the expression, just joking. He could see by the expression of their faces that they were praying. And these ladies, while he's preaching, are praying. I thought y'all were sleeping. But y'all are praying. And at the close of the service, they would say to him, "We have been praying for you." And D.L. Moody would say and think this, "Why don't you pray for the people?" Mr. Moody would ask, "Because you need the power of the Spirit," was their reply. "I need the power? Why?" said he. And this is what he's thinking. He's not saying it. In relating the incident afterwards, "I thought I had power. I had the largest congregation in Chicago. There were many conversations. I was in a sense of being satisfied." He was just satisfied where he is. He's sitting and he's like, "God's blessing. What do you think I need something more?" And most of us, we just live as if we don't need God. We get up and eat and write checks and live our life. Most of us aren't looking for anything deeper with God. We just like where we are. But right along those two godly women kept praying for me, and their earnest talk about anointing for special service set me thinking. I asked them to come and talk to me, and they poured out their hearts in prayer that I might receive the filling of the Holy Spirit. There came a great hunger in my soul, and I pray God for a hunger. When we read Psalms, I thirst after, I pant after. There should be a hunger for the things of God. I began to cry out as I never did before. I really felt that I did not want to live if I could not have this power for service. So he realized the lack of power. And he's asking God to work. While Mr. Moody was in this mental and spiritual condition, says his son, Chicago was laid in ashes. The great fire swept out of existence both Farwell Hall and Illinois Street Church. So get a tragedy in your mind, will you? This is a lot of times I don't want to pray for God to work. Because a lot of times, we read the Bible, a lot of times before God works, he levels the place. Why? Because there's so a lot of things we're holding on to that God wants to get rid of. What was his source of pride? That church and ministry. God walked it out. On Sunday night, after the meeting, as Mr. Moody went homeward, he saw the glare of the flames and knew it meant ruins to Chicago. About 1 o'clock, Farwell Hall was burned, and soon his church went down. Everything was scattered. Mr. Moody went east to New York City to collect funds for sufferers from the Chicago fire. Some say he went to just collect money to build his church. So this guy's being nice. I don't know if he's looking for the sufferer or he's the sufferer wanting money. But his heart and soul were crying out for the power from on high. My heart was not in the work of begging. I love that. Isn't that sad? Pastors have to beg back then and still have to beg now. Because they need it for the work. Says he, "I could not appeal. I was crying all the time that God would fill me with his Spirit." Well, one day in the city of New York. In New York? Spirit of God find someone in New York? Must have been different 100 years ago. Oh, what a day. I cannot describe it. I seldom refer to it. It wasn't about the experience. It's about what God's about to do in his life. You understand? Because people want to copy other people's experience. That's why, next week, when we start to look at the filling of the Spirit, Jesus did it different every time. Or in the New Testament church, it just poured out different every time. Why? Because he didn't want us to go, "Hey, let's build a spiritual computer. So every time we push the letter A, it works." It's about a relationship. We got to get some thoughts going. I seldom refer to it. It's almost too scary of an experience to name. Paul had an experience which he never spoke of for 14 years. Remember, he said he was whether in the body or out of body. I don't know. He had an understanding with God. I can only say that God revealed himself to me, and I had such an experience of his love that I had to ask him to stay his hand. When you see God high and lifted up, and it's not about the experience, you go, woe unto me. Woe unto me. Listen, the Spirit of love that I've asked him to stay his hand. I went to preaching again, and I love this. This is why I'd like to see the Spirit of God move. The sermons were not different. I did not present any new truth, and yet hundreds were converted. I mean, so people, I'll get people to say, they say, hey, read this sermon. This guy, boy, the Spirit of God's on it. And I'm just reading it. You know, and when you're reading it, the Spirit ain't working like it is in the thing. And I'm reading it and I'm going, that ain't very good at all. You know what I mean? What's it missing? Spirit of God. Spirit of God working in me. I would not now be placed back where I was before that blessed experience. If you should give me all the world, it would be as small dust of the balance. His soul was set on fire in such a way that his work would soon become a worldwide one. So this morning, I want you to understand, we have access to the Spirit, but you've got to be saved and baptized and in the Spirit to get in. I believe physical baptism is a picture of that, and I don't think you can have God on you in a supernatural way unless you're obedient to baptism. It's the first step of obedience. I really think it's part of what God says and does. Baptism in the water is an important thing. It's not just something we do. Okay? Now, so let me try to finish up. You pay attention because you sang to me. Baptism is... God throw someone under the bus, right? Here, baptism of the Spirit happens at salvation. Romans 8:9. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's what? None of his. You got to have it. This morning, if you repented, listen, someone told me they were a Christian all their life, and I just cringed in my spirit. Because you can't be a Christian all your life. There's got to be a point where you repent and receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Now, if you mean Christian as a follower of Christ, you could have been raised in a Christian home and lived a Christian life. If you mean that, that's fine. But if you think you got saved when someone sprinkled you as a baby, you're not saved. That just made your mom and daddy feel good. And I don't downplay it. I really, you know, when we do a baby dedication as Baptists, we try to stay so far away from it. I have no problem with bringing a child, setting it apart, and dedicating it for God. And I don't really care if we say this water's anointed and we sprinkle the baby. Isn't that crazy? I don't know. Paul somewhere along the way pulled out a handkerchief and said, hey, let's send this to everybody. And it worked. I don't have a problem. But if you think it's salvation that happens there, that's when it becomes a problem. It, because you've got to come to a place in life where you say, I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And so, baptize then into the body. Galatians 3:27. For as many of you have been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. Christ literally baptizes us in the Spirit, placing us into the body, which also makes us alive, Ephesians 2:1. And you have he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. I don't know about you. There's days I don't feel alive, but I praise God he has an itinerary and I'm in. I understand he has a plan and I'm in on what God's doing. And I don't want to lose sight of what the power and the Spirit of God is. So over the next few weeks, we're going to try to unpack what's happening. But I believe in those few verses we looked at, listen, the filling of the Spirit starts to do something else, which comes after the baptism of the Spirit. So you can have the baptism of the Spirit and not be filled with the Spirit. And so we're going to try to break that out, which is tough on Baptist people. But I think we need it. I'm all for the Spirit. Never been against Spirit. I'm against people just want to be emotional for emotional sake. That's all. That's all I'm against. Because I've seen way too many people so emotional on Monday and such a back center on Sunday and such a back center on Monday. If your spirit got a hold of you in that way, you're going to have a little more on Monday. It doesn't, the tank don't run that quick empty. You know what I'm saying? Okay. And so I hate that I throw out clarifiers all the time, but I passed it too long. If you're saved, you have the Spirit this morning. I pray that you're saved. If you're not saved this morning, I pray God convicts you by the Spirit that you need a Savior, that you'll repent and receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. I pray that this morning. I really do. The Spirit of God will then indwell you. God will give you the Spirit. It's called an earnest money, a down payment of the hope that it's like putting a wedding ring on you. You know what I'm saying? A gave you a ring saying, you're mine. You belong to me. You don't cause the baptism of the Spirit. Baptism of the Spirit happens. Do you understand that? Please get that. You got the Spirit of God. Third, you're made alive in Christ. Many of us are told we're alive, you know, but they're dead. Spirit makes you alive. And I hope you get that this morning. God has a plan. Join me. This morning, as we look at the baptism of the Spirit, and I know because of time and brevity of all that's going on the day of Pentecost, it was on God's itinerary. God was going to bring the Spirit of God, and God was going to fill the people of God with His Spirit. This morning, if you're saved, now listen, this is important. If you're saved, why do I keep saying if you're saved? If you've never been convicted or you repented and asked what Jesus Christ did on the cross to be a payment for your sin, you may not be saved. And then the Spirit of God comes in you and messes you up. It changes you. See, after you see the resurrection of Christ, God works and moves. And so we need to praise God for the Spirit of God. Amen? Praise God for the Spirit of God. We need a pouring out of the Spirit of God. We need a moving of the Spirit of God. We need God to work and move in our heart. Not for an experience. Listen, there's some experience that comes with it, but not for an experience, but for the work. Every time there's a feeling of God in Scripture, God does something. Souls get saved. It's never an isolated, we're going to have an experience. It's for the furtherance of the gospel. It's for the work of the ministry. And so I pray this morning this foundation helps you. Because I feel bad that there's people who think they don't have the Spirit. God gave it to you, you gotta say. You're His child. Stand with me. Attitude of prayer this morning. Father, I thank you so much for your word. And Lord, I thank you that because of the resurrection, we could be different. I thank you one day I repented my sins and you become my Savior and you baptized me into your body through your Spirit. I thank you, Father, for the understanding even through water baptism that I'm placed within the church. And Father, I just pray this morning. I pray that our people will say, hey, let me just walk through Scripture. Let me try to get a hold of the understanding of the Spirit of God and the power of God. Help me, Father, to see what is really there. And Father, Lord, help us to understand that you want to indwell us, empower us to do service. You've given us a gift by your Spirit, and you want to equip us by your Spirit to work out that gift in our lives. And so I pray, Father, for your Spirit to just work in accordance to your word. We praise you. We thank you. We glorify you. Jesus' name. As we sing, however God has worked and moved, you come this morning.